Okay.
I'd like to welcome everybody to the May meeting of District 6 Community Planners. We'll start off with introductions. My name's Marvin Phillips. I'm board chair, 40-year resident of Tenderloin, and I live on the 12th floor of this building. I welcome you all to the neighborhood.
Go over here.
Hi, sorry, I'm trying to plug. I'm Julie Flynn. I work in the planning department. I'm here for this center presentation.
Plugs right in the table.
Oh, okay, great, thanks.
I'm Patrick Race. I'm also with the planning department with the Civic Center Public Ground Plan Update.
Thank you.
Susan?
Oh, I'm Susan Bryan. I'm the videographer, and I'm a resident of the Tenderloin. I live down the street. Okay.
I'm Reginald Meadows. I live here in the building.
Oh, wait, wait.
I'm also up on the board and I live in this building on the 11th floor.
I'm Duffy. I live next door.
Okay.
Ma'am?
Hi. Kristen Hogan. I'm with the Department of Emergency Management.
Yeah.
Hi, Commander David Lazar, San Francisco Police Department, Community Engagement Division.
Thank you.
Pat McCormick, Sergeant Tenderloin Station, right down the street.
Uh-huh.
If you need me, I'm less than a block
away. Oh, okay. All right, all right.
Officer Sean Navarro, Community Engagement Division.
I'm Kat Carter. I'm with San Francisco Transit Riders.
Calvin Hong, I'm with J.S. Sullivan Development.
John Heimdall with J.S. Sullivan.
Okay.
So then, Bill Montani. Business owner in the Tenderloin.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, where is he?
Our ground rules we have. We ask people to turn off pagers, cell phones, laptops, tablets, electronic devices. Anything that might go beep. The reason we do that is we videotape this meeting. We post it on YouTube and other places. If you don't want to be videotaped, we ask that you stay behind the camera. We also ask there's no hackling or name calling. We want a safe environment created, like sign in, please, sir.
Sure.
We want a safe environment created which will give participants the freedom to feel free to speak by reserving any negative activity. We ask people to speak responsibly and emphasize on the positive. We also ask that you don't interrupt another speaker or engage in side conversations or other distracting behavior when others are speaking. Everybody should have a copy of the agenda. There is a change to the agenda. At the request of Commander Lazar, I have put him second, so everybody else has moved down one space. So is there any other additions to the agenda? Seeing none, do I have a motion to approve the agenda?
I so move.
Seconded?
Seconded.
All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you. We have a donation jar to help defer the cost of running an organization. So I ask people who can give to give. If you can't, I'm not worried about it. I'm sure the jar goes around. While the jar is going around, I'll give a little bit history for our organization because we have new faces. District 6 Community Planners came out of a group of residents who didn't want to see an end to this citizen involvement in the planning and development of our neighborhood. And we came together, we put together this organization, and we created a board, and we are on, this is our third meeting. All welcome. All are welcome. And we'll get started with Department of Emergency Management.
Well, good evening. Thank you all for inviting me here. My name is Kristen Hogan. I'm a public information officer and also part of our external affairs and public engagement team with the Department of Emergency Management. Has anybody heard of us before? Any of you? Okay. Well, we are probably a bit better well known as the city's 911 dispatch center. So I'm sure everyone's heard of 911. We dispatch our law enforcement partners to come and assist as needed. And then we also handle large scale emergency management. So that means for big things, potentially like an earthquake or a terrorist attack or even something that's celebratory like a World Series parade, we help to manage the citywide resources to make sure that, or try to mitigate the impact that the situation may have on the city at large. So we have the city's Emergency Operations Center within our building. We're actually located on 1011 Turk Street. That's where the Dispatch Center exists and also our Emergency Operations Center. So part of our mission as a department is we want to make sure that anyone who lives in, works in, and visits San Francisco knows what to do before, during, and after an emergency. And that includes both the everyday emergency, which may require you to call 911, and then the not so everyday emergency, which is something we would characterize as like an earthquake. So I'm here to talk to you a little bit about how to be prepared at home, but also hear about any questions you may have. And I also would like to leave with a call to action that you all register for our notification system, which is called Alert SF. Has anybody heard of Alert SF? Great.
I'm on it.
You're on it? Good. So I've got a little part that I'd like to leave if possible with you. But so during an emergency, like something like an earthquake or even maybe even something that's not quite as severe, but perhaps a fire that requires you to avoid the area or potentially a gas line break, what we need to do, we want to make sure that you're getting the information that we're sending out so that you can be safe and know what to do. So there's several mechanisms that we use to share what we call emergency public information. So at the most analog, I would invite you all to tell me what you hear every Tuesday at noon. This is alert. This is a test. This is a test of the emergency or the outdoor warning siren system. So that's actually our department as well. So we've got about 132 sirens staged throughout the city. So that's a mechanism that we would use. That's probably for more severe, significant emergencies, something like a tsunami warning, for example, we would use that. But if you hear that siren go off and it's not Tuesday at noon, that means that we're trying to alert you of something. So even if you can't understand what we're saying over the siren, try and seek out more information. Go to news, go to radio. If you follow social media, take a look at what's happening as well. And then whenever we would issue, if we were to initiate the sirens, we absolutely would also be sending out our Alert SFs too. So going back to Alert SF, this is what we use pretty much every day. In fact, we just sent out an Alert SF maybe about an hour ago, because there's a fire, I think, in the Richmond district. So we sent it out. You wouldn't get it unless you registered for alerts in that zip code. But for anybody who uses a cell phone, everybody here uses a cell phone? Okay. So I won't force you to do it now because I'll let you process it, but it's quite simple. All you need to do is text to a short code, which is 888-777. So there's no area code needed, but as if you're just sending a message to that as a phone number. And then you can text your zip code. And then you can actually register as many zip codes as you'd like. So if you live in one part of the city, or your children go to a school in a different part of the city, or you work somewhere else, you can register for any part of the city that you'd like to. If you want citywide alerts, like everything, you can just text message the word Alert SF, all one word. So can I leave this with you? Stand up. So I hope that you all consider opting into that service, because it's something that we use more frequently than potentially, like I said, the sirens. So getting information is key. Who here feels like they're prepared for something like an earthquake? Well, there's good news. You're more prepared than you think, I swear. So being prepared for emergencies really just takes into account three simple steps. So I'll leave this here too. The first step is you've got to make your plan. So you've got to think through scenarios. If you're not at home and it's in the middle of the day, and something happens, say like an earthquake, what would you do? Who do you need to get in contact with? Where would you go if you can't get back to your apartment or where you live? So thinking through those scenarios, I've brought with me here a little worksheet that actually just lets you simply make your plan. It's really not complicated or even, it's certainly not rocket science, but it just gives you a chance to sort of think through these questions before the emergency, when you're clear-headed, you're not stressed out, and you kind of thought it through. And when you think through these things beforehand, it kind of makes you feel more prepared and more, you'll enjoy a greater sense of peace of mind that you've thought through some things, so that when you're actually in that situation, it may become a little bit more second nature. Oh yeah, sure, thanks. So the second thing to do to be prepared is you've got to have supplies. So as we pass out this card with the plan part of it, on the other side, these are some basic supplies that you should have on hand. So I'd be willing to bet money that everybody here has at least one thing on this card, whether it's an extra can of food, a manual can opener, potentially a flashlight or batteries, but it's just things that you want to have on hand and try and add to it if you can. I know that a lot of apartments don't have a lot of space to store an extra or a lot of food, but the good news is you don't need an expensive earthquake kit or a cache of supplies or a bomb shelter or something to be prepared. It's just having what you need for probably at least 3 days. So you're thinking about if you were have enough supplies at home for everybody in your household for 9 meals. So that means water, extra food that's non-perishable. Think about what you would need to do if you don't have electricity, and potentially if water is cut off for a while. And again, I'm going to go back to our alert warning systems, Alert SF, and so forth. We'll be sending out information during those situations when everyday resources are not available, so that you'll know how to get what you need. And then the third part and final of how to be prepared is going back to Alert SF and being, or whatever news resource you use, get connected to information. But also get connected within your network. So you all being here today is a step in your preparedness because you're getting connected within your community. So I think the majority of you all, does everybody live in this building, or at least is it in the neighborhood?
Neighborhood.
Okay. So you all turning to each other. So if there's something like a catastrophic earthquake, people will help each other. So knowing your neighbors, knowing who may need extra assistance, and then thinking about them and checking on them and so forth. So that's how cities, how we'll recover from something challenging like an earthquake. There's a saying we have in emergency management, but it's that emergencies look more like cities coming together than falling apart. And we as San Franciscans are people who have demonstrated that through many types of adversity, whether it's earthquake, or social injustice, or so forth. So I think that's all I'd like to impart with you when it comes to the basics of preparedness. Think of it in threes. So get connected, make your plan, get some supplies, and then talk about it with each other, check on each other, and then when the situation occurs, you'll be able to respond all the more effectively. So, questions? Yes?
TNDC, which manages our building, has 40 properties. And what can we pass on to them for them to deal with all of their residents?
I think that the most tactical and effective mechanism
This is my concern, because not everybody has cell phones. And not everybody has Twitter that has cell phones.
But your property managers probably do have that information. So they can become a connection point to the people that they serve. So them being connected to the information, I think, is an imperative and simple first step.
The other piece of it is a lot of the stuff you have on here, like Medi-Cal doesn't allow to get extra prescriptions. You can only get what you get, what your doctor prescribes for the time period. You can't get extra unless you pay cash for it. And extra cash, I would say probably a percentage of the neighborhood doesn't have the monetary resources to have cash just sitting around for not, that they don't actually need. So, I mean, is there programs also to help stop emergency kits that you keep talking about, we see all the time, for people who are on low income and really extremely low-income residents and, for that matter, the homeless.
Well, we, as I said earlier, you don't need an earthquake kit to be prepared for emergency. Most likely, you'll be able to stay at home. So it's important to, again, have some extra supplies and then have the ability to, you know, like I said, have a manual can opener to open up your food in the event that there's no electricity. I'm not sure if anybody really even uses electric can openers. I think they're ineffective too. But there's just, you know, you've got to kind of think through those personal scenarios and what you would do if you were not able to access everyday resources for at least 3 days. So these are examples within that useful and personal. So think about what you as a person and what you need. We as a city are not going to be able to understand or provide every single individual an additional amount of prescriptions per se. So there's going to be challenges and there's going to be some problem solving that takes place in the moment, which may turn out to be truly innovative solutions. It's hard to think through every scenario that could happen. But these are just parameters and guidelines that can help you to be more prepared. When it comes to things like cash, what we really mean is that it's better to have small bills or even coins, a few, because if there's a situation where electricity is out, for example, in Superstorm Sandy, people weren't able to use their ATM cards, and so people could only use cash. But if you had high, like a 20, and you went to get something that cost $5, you might not get cash back. So small bills, not necessarily many, many small bills, but some small bills.
Part, and I think I talked to you on the phone about this. There's a fairly substantial population of this building that's Chinese. And this neighborhood, we have over 100 different languages and cultures. Is there any resources you can think of that the city can assist this neighborhood in getting prepared to meet the need? Because there are a lot of Indo-Chinese organizations which can reach out to their tenants, but getting information out to the organizations may be an avenue to consider when putting out information on what to do if.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. In fact, we do have a robust partnership with organizations that provide services, whether it's people who are monolingual speaking communities or even people who may be homebound or require in-home supportive services. So we have through, the city has a lot of contracts and partnerships that are set up to help a variety of demographics throughout the city. And so we actually have that contact information, because in some cases they're actually paid by the city to provide these services. So we leverage them, communicate with them, we train them so that when there's an emergency, they can actually be the ones carrying the message and the information to those they serve. So there's not a one-size-fits-all bullseye answer to the complicated, you know, an inevitable mess that something like an earthquake will cause. But the good news is there's a lot you can do beforehand that will make it easier in the aftermath. So it's not necessarily the fear of the earthquake that should inspire us to get prepared, but just thinking about a few things you can do now that will make a huge difference afterwards. And the role of the Department of Emergency Management in those complicated situations, such as a catastrophic earthquake, is that, you know, in our Emergency Operations Center, we will be pulling in any organization or agency that would have a role in that response and pull them together into this one big room, and then we problem solve together. And then we have plans in place with a variety of organizations, both city departments, but also non-city or community-based organizations. So we have a very formalized and regularly used system with our voluntary organizations that act in disasters. So that's the Red Cross, Salvation Army, other faith-based groups. We work very closely with the Interfaith Council, which represents every faith-based group within the city, and we work together with them to try and so they can help us to provide the resources or the situational awareness across the board, so that we can try and do whatever we can to save lives and help to mitigate damage to property.
Any questions,
please? Yes.
Backup batteries. They're very good for keeping your phones and things I got this up.
Oh, that's great.